Thank you, Dr. Campbell, for your presentation. Now we have Brother Sabil Ahmed presenting an introduction of our next speaker, Dr. Zakir Naik.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. It is my pleasure to introduce one of the best scholars of our time, Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik, age 34 years old. He is the president of Islamic Research Foundation, Bombay, India. Though a medical doctor with professional training, Dr. Zakir Naik is known as a dynamic international orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Zakir Naik clarifies Islamic viewpoints and clears misconceptions about Islam based upon the Quran, Hadith, and other religious scriptures, as well as adhering to reason, logic, and scientific facts. He is popular for his critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audiences after his public talks. In the last 4 years itself, Dr. Zakir Naik has delivered more than 400 public lectures worldwide, in addition to many public talks in India. He appears regularly on many international TV and satellite TV channels, programs in several countries of the world. He has authored books on Islam and comparative religion. He has also participated in several symposiums and dialogues with prominent personalities of other religious faiths.
May I announce, after the talks by both the speakers and the response session, we would be having an open question and answer session. So those who have come late, kindly note we'll have questions on the mics followed by questions on index cards. Ladies and gentlemen, may I call upon Dr. Zakir Naik to present his talk.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam, ala rasulillah, wa ala ali wa sahbihi ajma'in, amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Sanurihim ayatina fil afaqi, wa fi anfusihim, hatta yatabayyana lahum annahu al-haq, awalam yakfi bi rabbika, annahu ala kulli shay'in shahid, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, rabbi shrah li sadri, wa yassir li amri. Respected Dr. William Campbell, Dr. Marakas, Dr. Jamal Badwi, Brother Samuel Noman, Dr. Muhammad Naik, my respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. The topic of today's dialogue is the Quran and the Bible in the light of science. The glorious Quran is the last and final revelation which was revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. For any book to claim that it is a revelation from Almighty God, it should stand the test of time. Previously, in the olden days, it was the age of miracles. Alhamdulillah, the Quran is the miracle of miracles. Later on came the age of literature and poetry. And Muslims and non-Muslims alike, they claim the glorious Quran to be the best Arabic literature available on the face of the earth. But today is the age of science and technology. Let us analyze whether the Quran is compatible or incompatible with modern science. Albert Einstein said, "Science without religion is lame, and religion without science is blind." Let me remind you that the glorious Quran is not a book of science, science. It's a book of science, science. It's a book of ayats. And there are more than 6,000 signs, ayats, in the glorious Quran, out of which more than 1,000 speak about science. As far as my talk regarding Quran and science is concerned, I will only be speaking about scientific facts which have been established. I will not be speaking about scientific hypotheses and theories which are based on assumption without any proof, because we all know many a times science takes U-turns. Dr. William Campbell, who wrote a reply to the book of Dr. Maurice Bucaille, The Quran, the Bible, and the Light of History and Science, he says in his book that there are two types of approaches. One is a concordist approach, which means a person tries to bring a compatibility between the scripture and science. And the other is the conflict approach, in which a person tries to bring a conflict between scripture and science, like how Dr. William Campbell has done very well. But as far as the Quran is concerned, irrespective whether a person uses a conflicting approach or a concordist approach, as long as you're logical, and after a logical explanation is given to you, not a single person will be able to prove a single verse of the Quran in conflict with established modern science. Dr. William Campbell has pointed out various alleged scientific errors in the Quran, and I'm supposed to actually refute in the rebuttal, but since he chose to speak first, I will be refuting a few points in my talk. I will reply to the major part of his talk, mainly dealing with embryology and with geology. The remaining, inshallah, I will try my level best to reply in the rebuttal. I have to do both. I can't do injustice to the topic. The topic is Quran and Bible in the light of science. I can't only speak about one scripture. Dr. William Campbell hardly spoke about one or two points about the Bible, which I shall deal with, inshallah. I will speak about both, inshallah. I want to do justice to the topic. As far as Quran and modern science is concerned, in the field of astronomy, the scientists, the astronomers, a few decades earlier, they described how the universe came into existence. They called it the Big Bang. And they said initially there was one primary nebula, which later on it separated with a Big Bang, which gave rise to galaxies, stars, sun, and the earth we live in. This information is given in a nutshell in the glorious Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 30, which says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Do not the unbelievers see, أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتْ رَتْكًا فَسَقْنَهُمَا. That the heaven and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. Imagine, this information which they came to know recently, the Quran mentions 1400 years ago. When I was in school, I had learned that the sun, in respect to the earth, it was stationary. The earth and the moon, they rotated about the axis, but the sun was stationary. But when I read a verse of the Quran saying, in Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 33, it says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ. It is Allah who has created the night and the day. وَالشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ. The sun and the moon. كُلٌّ فِي فَلَكِ يَسْبَحُونَ. Each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. Now, alhamdulillah, modern science has confirmed the Quranic statement. The Arabic word used in the Quran is yasbahun, which describes the motion of a moving body. When it refers to a celestial body, it means it is rotating about its own axis. So Quran says the sun and the moon, they revolve as well as rotate about their own axis. Today we have come to know that the sun takes approximately 25 days to complete one rotation. It was Edwin Hubble who discovered that the universe is expanding. The Quran says in Surah Dhariyat, chapter 51, verse number 47, that we have created the expanding universe, the vastness of space. The Arabic word Mosiona refers to vastness, the expanding universe. Regarding the topics on astronomy which Dr. William Campbell touched, I will deal in the rebuttal, inshallah. In the field of water cycle, Dr. William Campbell pointed out certain things. The Quran describes the water cycle in great detail. And Dr. William Campbell mentioned four stages. In his book, he mentions 4A and B. The last one he didn't mention in the slide, I don't know why. It says that replenishing the water table, he missed out here, maybe because it's not mentioned in the Bible. He said there is not a single verse in the Quran which speaks about evaporation. Quran says in Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 11, Rajus Sama, that by the capacity of the heavens to return. And almost all the commentators of the Quran, they said that this verse of Surah Tariq, chapter 86, verse number 11, refers to the capacity of the heaven to return back rain, meaning evaporation. Dr. William Campbell, who knows Arabic, may say, why didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically mention wasamai zatil matar, meaning the capacity of the heaven to return back rain? Why did Allah mention specifically? Now we have come to know why didn't Allah do that in his divine wisdom. Because today we have come to know that besides the ozonosphere, the layer above the earth, besides returning back rain, it even returns back other beneficial matter and energy of the earth which is required by the human beings. It does not only return back rain, today we have come to know it even returns back waves of telecommunication, of television, of radio, by which we can see TV, we can communicate, we can hear the radio. And besides that, it even returns back the harmful rays of the outer space back on the other side and absorbs. For example, the sunlight, the ultraviolet rays of the sunlight is absorbed by the ionosphere. If this was not done, life on the earth would have ceased to exist. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is far superior and far more accurate when it says Rajas Sama, by the capacity of the heaven to return. And the remaining things, as he mentioned, is there in the Quran. You can refer to my video cassette. The Quran described the water cycle in great detail. Regarding what he said about the Bible, he showed stage 1 and stage 3 in the first slide. And the second, stage 1, 3, and then 2. That the rainwater is taken up, he says, and then the rainwater comes down on the earth. This is the philosophy of Phaedo of Miletus in 7th century BC. He thought that the spray of the ocean was picked up by the wind and fell into the interior as rain. There's no cloud mentioned there. In the second quotation Dr. William Campbell gave, first is, according to him, evaporation, which we agree, we don't mind having the concordance approach with the Bible. Then rain falls down and then other clouds formed. That is not the complete water cycle. Alhamdulillah, the Quran describes the water cycle in great detail, in several places. How does the water rise, evaporates, form into clouds, the clouds join together, they stack up, there's thunder and lightning, water comes down, the clouds move into the interior, they fall down as rain, and the replenishing of the water table, and alhamdulillah, in great detail. The Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail in several places. In Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 43. In Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse 48. In Surah Az-Zumar, chapter 39, verse 21. In Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 18. In Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 24. In Surah Al-Hijr, chapter 15, verse number 22. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 57. In Surah Ra'd, chapter number 13, verse number 17. In Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse number 48 and 49. In Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 9. In Surah Yasin, chapter 36, verse number 34. In Surah Jasha, chapter 45, verse number 5. In Surah Qaf, chapter number 50, verse number 9. In Surah Waqia, chapter number 56, verse number 68 and 70. In several places, Surah Mulk, chapter 67, verse number 30, the glorious Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail. Dr. William Campbell spent maximum time on embryology, about half his talk, quite a lot on geology, and touched on other six topics. I've noted down. In the field of geology, we have come to know today, the geologists tell us that the radius of the earth is approximately 3,750 miles. And the deeper layers, they are hot and fluid and cannot sustain life. And the superficial part of the Earth's crust which we live on, it is very thin, hardly 1 to 30 miles. Some portions are thicker, but majority 1 to 30 miles. And there are high possibility that this superficial layer, the Earth's crust, it will shake. It is due to the folding phenomena which gives rise to mountain ranges, which gives stability to this earth. And Quran says in Surah Naba, chapter number 78, verse number 6 and 7, we have made the earth as an expanse, wal jabala autada, and the mountains as stakes. The Quran doesn't say mountains were thrown up as stakes. Mountains as stakes. Arabic word autad means stakes, meaning tent peg. And today we have come to know, in the study of modern geology, that mountain has got deep roots. This was known in the second half of the 19th century. And the superficial part that we see of the mountain is a very small percentage. The deeper part is within, exactly like a stake, how it is driven in the ground. You can only see a small part on top, the majority is down in the ground. Or like a tip of the iceberg, you can see the tip on the top, and about 90% is beneath water. The Quran says in Surah Ghashiyah, chapter 88, verse number 19, and Surah Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 32. Wal jibala arsaha, and we have made the mountain standing firm on the earth. Made the mountain standing firm on the earth. Today, after modern geology has advanced, and Otto William Campbell said that, by the theory of plate tectonics, it was propounded in 1960, which gives rise to mountain ranges, the geologists today do say that the mountains give stability to the earth. Not all geologists, but many do say. I have not come across a single geological book, and I challenge Dr. William Campbell to produce a single geological book, not his personal correspondence with the geologist. That doesn't carry weight. His personal correspondence with Dr. Keith Moore, documented proof. And if you read the book, The Earth, which is referred by almost all the universities in the field of geology, one of its authors, by the name of Dr. Frank Press, who was the advisor to the former president of USA, Jimmy Carter, and was the president of the Academy of Sciences of USA, he writes in his book that the mountains are wedge-shaped, it has deep roots within, and he says that the function of the mountain is to stabilize the earth. And the Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 31, in Surah Luqman, chapter 31, verse number 10, as well as in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 15, that we have made the mountain standing firm on the earth, lest it would shake with them and with you. The function of the mountain in the Quran is given to prevent the earth from shaking. Nowhere does the Quran say that the mountain prevents the earthquake. And Dr. William Campbell said, he writes in his book and even the talk, that you find in the mountainous regions there are various earthquakes, and mountains cause earthquake. Point to be noted, nowhere does the Quran say that mountain prevents earthquake. The Arabic word for earthquake, as Dr. William Campbell knows Arabic, is zilzal or zalzala. But the words used in these three verses I quoted, it is tamida. Tamida means to shake, to sway, to swing. And Quran says in Surah Luqman, chapter 31, verse number 10, as well as Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse 15, we have put on the earth mountain standing firm, lest it would shake with you. It is tamida bikum, shake with you, indicating if the mountain were not there, if you would have walked, if you would have moved, even the earth would have moved with you. If you would have swayed, even the earth would have swayed with you. And we know normally when we walk on the earth doesn't shake. And the reason for this is, according to Dr. Frank Press and Dr. Najjar, who's from Saudi Arabia, and he wrote a full book on geological concepts in the Quran, answering almost everything what Dr. William Campbell has said in detail. And Dr. William Campbell, in his book, he writes that if mountains prevent the shaking of the earth, then how come you find earthquake in the mountainous regions? I said, nowhere does the Quran say mountain prevents earthquake. Earthquake is zilzal. And if you see the definition in the Oxford Dictionary, it says, earthquake is due to convulsion of the superficial crust of the earth due to release of compressed seismic waves due to crack in the rock or due to volcanic reaction. Quran speaks about Zalzala in Surah Zalzal, chapter 99, but here it speaks about Tamida Bikum, to prevent the earth from shaking with you. And in reply to the statement that if mountains prevent earthquakes, how come you find earthquakes in mountainous region? The reply is that if I say that medical doctors, they prevent the sickness and disease in a human being, and if someone argues, if doctors prevent the sickness and diseases in a human being, how come you find more sick people in the hospital where there are doctors than at home where there are no doctors? In the field of oceanology, the glorious Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse number 53, that it is Allah who has let free two bodies of flowing water, one sweet and palatable, the other salt and bitter. Though they meet, they do not mix. Between them, there is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespassed. Quran says in Surah Rahman, chapter 55, verse number 19 and 20, Maraj al bahrain yaltaqiyan baynahuma barzakhun la yabghiyan. It is Allah who has let free two bodies of flowing water. Though they meet, they do not mix. Between them, there is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespassed. Previously, the commentator of the Quran wondered, what does the Quran mean? We know about sweet and salt water, but between them there is a barrier, though they meet, do not mix. Today, after advancement of oceanology, we have come to know that whenever one type of water flows into the other type of water, it loses its constituents and gets homogenized into the water it flows. There is a slanting, homogenizing area which the Quran refers to as barzakh, unseen barrier. And this has been agreed upon by several scientists, even of America, by the name of Dr. Hay. He's an oceanologist. And Dr. William Campbell writes in his book that it is an observable phenomena. The fishermen of that time knew there were two types of water, salt and sweet. So Prophet Muhammad, during his expedition to Syria, he may have gone in the sea or he might have spoken to these fishermen. Sweet and salt water is an observable phenomena, I agree. But people did not know that there was an unseen barrier until recently. The scientific point to be noted here is the barzakh, not the sweet and the salt water. In the field of embryology, Dr. William Campbell spent approximately half of his talk on that. Time will not permit me to reply to every small thing which are illogical. I'll just give a brief reply, which will be satisfactory, inshallah. And for more details, you can refer to my video cassette, Quran Modern Science, and my other cassettes on Quran and Medical Science. There were a group of Arabs who collected the data dealing in the Quran about embryology and the Hadith dealing with embryology, and they presented it to Professor Kitmu, who was the chairman and the head of the Department of Anatomy in the University of Toronto in Canada. And at present, he's one of the leading scientists in the field of embryology. After reading the various translations of the Quran, he was asked to comment, and he said, most of the verses of the Quran and the Hadith are in perfect conformity with modern embryology. But there are a few verses which I cannot say that they are right. Neither can I say that they are wrong, because I myself don't know about it. And two such verses were the first verse of the Quran to be revealed, from Surah Iqra or Surah Alaq, chapter 96, verse number 1 and 2, which says, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Khalaq al-insana min alaq. Read, recite, or proclaim in the name of thy Lord, who created the human beings from something which clings, a leech-like substance. Regarding Dr. William Campbell's statement that to analyze the meaning of a word, you have to see what was the meaning at that time when it was revealed, at that time when the book was written. And he rightly said that to analyze the meaning, you have to analyze the meaning at the time it was revealed and to the people who it was meant for. As far as this statement of his is concerned, regarding the Bible, I do agree with it totally, because the Bible was only meant for the children of Israel for that time. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 10, verse number 5 and 6. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, tells his disciples, go ye not in the way of the Gentiles. Who are the Gentiles? The non-Jews, the Hindus, the Muslims. But rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 15, verse number 24, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So Jesus Christ and the Bible were only meant for the children of Israel. Since it was meant for them, to analyze the Bible, you have to use the meaning of the word which was utilized at that time. But the Quran was not meant only for the Arabs of that time. Quran is not meant only for the Muslims. The Quran is meant for the whole of humanity. And it is meant to be for eternity. Quran says in Surah Ibrahim chapter 14 verse 52, in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse 185, and Surah Zumar chapter 39 verse 41, that the Quran is meant for the whole of humankind. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was not sent only for the Muslims or the Arabs. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Anbiya chapter number 21 verse number 107, Bama arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin, that we have sent thee as a mercy, as a guidance to the whole of humankind. So as far as the Quran is concerned, you cannot limit the meaning only for that time, because it is meant for eternity. So one of the meanings of alaqa is leech-like substance or something which clings. So Prophet Keith Moore said, I do not know whether the early stage of embryo looks like a leech. And he went in his laboratory and he analyzed the early stage of an embryo under a microscope and compared it with a photograph of a leech, and he was astonished at the striking resemblance. This is the photograph of a leech and human embryo. What Dr. William Campbell showed you is the other perspective of it. If I show this book, it looks like a rectangle. If I show you like that, it's a different perspective. That diagram is given in the book. The diagram which is shown on the slide is given there, and I'll deal with it, inshallah. Professor Keith Moore, after about 80 questions were asked to him, he said, if you would have asked me these 80 questions 30 years ago, I would not be able to answer more than 50%, because embryology has developed recently in the past 30 years. He said this in the 80s. Now, do we believe in Dr. Keith Moore, whose statement is available outside in the foyer, if video cassettes are available? This is the truth, unknown haq, recorded statement. So will you believe Dr. William Campbell's personal conversation with Professor Keith Moore? Or the one mentioned in this book, with Islamic edition, as well as the photograph that I've shown to you? And in the video cassette available outside, you can see it. He makes those statements. So you have to choose which is more logical. Personal discussion with Dr. William Campbell, or his statement on video, like how Dr. William Campbell showed my video. 100% proof what I said. Moon is reflected light. I'll come to it later on. And whatever additional information he got from Quran and Hadith, it was incorporated later into the book, The Developing Human, the third edition. And this book got an award for the best medical book written by a single author in that year. This is the Islamic edition that was put forward by Sheikh Abdul Majid Zindani and certified by Keith Moore himself. The Quran says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 13, and Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 5, and no less than 11 different places in the Quran, that the human beings have been made from anutfa, a minute quantity of liquid. Like a trickle that's remaining in the cup, nutfa in Arabic, a very small quantity. Today we have come to know, in one seminal emission, in which there are several millions of sperm, only one is required to fertilize the ovum. The Quran refers as nutfa. Quran says, in Surah Sajdah, chapter 32, verse number 8, we have created the human beings from sulala. That means the best part of a whole. The one sperm which fertilizes the ova, out of the millions of sperm, the Quran refers to as sulala, best part of the whole. And Quran says in Surah Insan, chapter 76, verse number 2, we have created the human beings from nutfatin amshaj, a minute quantity of mingled fluid, referring to the sperm as well as the ovum. Both are required for the fertilization. The Quran describes the various embryological stages in great detail, of which the slide was shown to you. Dr. William Campbell, he helped me to complete this topic. It's mentioned in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 12 to 14. The translation is that we have created the human beings from anutfa, a minute quantity of liquid, then placed it in aqrar-e makin, a place of security. Then we made it into an alaka, a leech-like substance, something which clings, a congealed clot of blood. Then we made that alaka into a mudga, a chewed-like lump. Then we made the mudga into idama, bones. Then clothed the bones with lahm, flesh. Then we made it a new creature. Blessed be Allah, who is the best to create. These three verses of the Quran speak about the various embryonic stages in great detail. First the nutfa, placed in a place of security, made into an alaka. Alaka has got three meanings. One is something which clings. And we know that in the initial stages, the embryo clings to the uterine wall and continues clinging till the end. Point number two, that it also means a leech-like substance. And as I discussed earlier, the embryo in the initial stages does look like a leech. Besides looking like a leech, it also behaves like a leech. It receives its blood supply from the mother, like a bloodsucker. And the third meaning, which Dr. William Campbell objected to, that is the right meaning, the congealed clot of blood, and that's why Quran has a scientific error. And I do agree with him that Dr. William Campbell didn't agree. He said, how can it mean a congealed clot of blood? Because this is the case, and the Quran is wrong. I'm sorry to say, Quran is not wrong. Dr. William Campbell, with due respect to him, he's wrong. Because today, after advancement of embryology, even Dr. Keith Moore, he says that in the initial stages, the embryo, besides looking like a leech, also looks like a congealed clot of blood. Because in the initial stages of the stage of alaka, 3 to 4 weeks, the blood is clotted within closed vessels. And Dr. William Campbell made it easy for me. He showed you a slide. It will be difficult for you to see, but this is the slide he showed you. This is exactly what Professor Keith Moore said looks like a clot, in which the blood is clotted within closed vessels, and during the third week of the embryo, the blood circulation doesn't take place. It starts later on. Therefore, it assumes the appearance of a clot. And even if you observe the conceptus, that's after abortion takes place, you can see it looks like a clot. Only one line answer is sufficient to answer all the allegations of Dr. William Campbell, is that the stages of the Quran, while it describes the embryologic stages, is only based on appearance. Appearance. First is the appearance of a alaka, a leech-like substance, as well as a clot of blood. And Dr. William Campbell rightly said that some ladies come and ask, please remove the clot. It does look like a clot. And the stages are based on appearance. It is created from something which appears like a clot, which appears like a leech, and is also something which clings. Then the Quran says we made that alaka into a mudga, a chewed like lump. Prophet Keith Moore took plaster seal and bit between his teeth to make it look like a mudga. The teeth mark resembled the somites. Dr. William Campbell said, when the alaka becomes a mudga, the clinging is yet there. It is dead late and half months. So, the Quran is wrong. I told you in the beginning, the Quran is describing the appearance. The leech-like appearance and the clot-like appearance is changed to the chewed-like appearance. It yet continues to cling till the end. There's no problem. But the stages are divided on appearance, not on the function. Later on, Quran says, we made the mudga into izama bones. Then clothed the bones with flesh. Dr. William Campbell said, and I do agree with him, that the precursors of the muscles and the cartilages, that is the bones, they form together. I agree with that. Today, embryology tells us that the primordia of the muscles and the bones, they form together between the 25th and the 40th day, which the Quran refers to as the stage of mudga. But they are not developed. They are not developed. Later on, at the end of the 7th week, the embryo takes form of human appearance, then the bones are formed. Today, modern embryology says the bones are formed after the 42nd day. And it gives an appearance of a skeletal thing. Even at this stage, when the bones are formed, the muscles aren't formed. Later on, after the 7th week and the starting of 8th week, are the muscles formed. So Quran is perfect in describing first alaqa, then mudga, then izaman, then clothed with flesh. And when they form, the description is perfect. And Professor Keith Moore said that the stages that how it is described in modern embryology, stage 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, is so confusing. The Quranic stage on embryology, describing on the base of appearance and the shape, is far more superior. Alhamdulillah. Therefore he said that I have no objection in accepting that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God and that this glorious Quran has to be a divine revelation from Almighty God. It's mentioned in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse 56. It speaks about pain. Previously, the doctors, they thought that the brain was only responsible for feeling of pain. Today we have come to know, besides the brain, there are certain receptors in the skin which are responsible for feeling of the pain, which we call as pain receptors. Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 56, that as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them into the hellfire, and as often as their skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. Indicating there is something in the skin. Professor Tagla Takashan, who is the head of the Department of Anatomy in Chiang Mai University in Thailand, only on the basis of this one verse, he proclaimed the Shahada in the 8th medical conference in Riyadh and said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, that there's no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. I started my talk by quoting the verse of the glorious Quran, from Surah Fusila, chapter 41, verse 53, which says, Sanurihim ayatina fil afaqi, bafi anfusihim, hatta yatabayyana lahum annahu al-haq, awalam yakfi bi rabbika, annahu ala kulli shay'in shaheed, that soon we shall show them our signs in the furthest region of the horizons and into their soul, until it is clear to them that this is the truth. This one verse was sufficient to prove to Dr. Tagla Takashan that Quran is a divine revelation. Some may require 10 signs, some may require 100, some even after 1,000 signs are given, they will not accept the truth. Quran calls such people as, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 18, summum, bukmun, umyun, fahum la arjiun, the deaf, the dumb, the blind, they will not return the true path. The Bible says the same thing in Gospel of Matthew chapter number 13 verse number 13, seeing they see not, hearing they hear not, neither will they understand. And regarding the other parts of embryology, I will deal in my rebuttal, inshallah, if time permits. I have to do justice to the other part also, regarding Bible and the light of science. At the outset, let me tell you that Quran says in Surah Ra'd, chapter 13, verse 38, that we have given several revelations. By name, only four are mentioned: the Torah, the Zabur, the Injil, and the Quran. The Torah is the Wahi, the revelation, which was given to Moses, peace be upon him. The Zabur is the Wahi, which was given to David, peace be upon him. The Injil is the Wahi, the revelation, which was given to Jesus, peace be upon him. And Quran is the last and final revelation, which was given to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Let me make it very clear to everyone that this Bible, which the Christians believe to be the word of God, is not the Injil which we Muslims believe was revealed to Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. This Bible, according to us, it may contain the words of God, but it also contains words of prophets, words of historians. It contains absurdities, obscenity, as well as innumerable scientific errors. If there are scientific points mentioned in the Bible, there are possibilities. Why not? It may be part of the word of God in the Bible. But what about the scientific errors? What about the unscientific portion? Can you attribute this to God? I want to make it very clear to my Christian brothers and sisters. The purpose of my presentation on Bible and science is not to hurt any Christian's feeling. If I hurt your feelings, I do apologize in advance. The purpose is only to point out that a God's revelation cannot contain scientific errors. As Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, search ye the truth, and the truth shall free you. You have the Old Testament, you have the New Testament. Now you should follow the last and final testament, which is the glorious Quran. As far as Dr. William Campbell is concerned, I can be more liberal with him because he has written a book, Quran, Bible in the Light of History and Science. He has given a presentation and he's a medical doctor. I don't have to be very formal with him. As far as the other Christian brothers and sisters are concerned, I apologize if I hurt your feelings during the presentation. Let's analyze what the Bible say about modern science. First, we deal with astronomy. The Bible speaks about the creation of the universe. In the beginning, first book, book of Genesis, first chapter, it's mentioned. It says, Almighty God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and talks about an evening and a morning, referring to a 24-hour day. Today, scientists tell us that the universe cannot be created in a 24-hour period of 6 days. Quran 2 speaks about six ayams. The Arabic word singular is yom, plural is ayam. It can either mean a day of 24 hours or it is a very long period, an eon, an epoch. Scientists say we have no objection in agreeing that the universe, it could have been created in six very long period. Point number two. Bible says in Genesis chapter number 1, verse 3 and 5, light was created on first day. Genesis chapter 1, verse 14 to 19, the cause of light, stars, and the sun, etc., was created on fourth day. How can the cause of light be created on the fourth day later than the light which came into existence on the first day? It's unscientific. Further, the Bible says, Genesis chapter 1, verse 9 to 13, earth was created on the third day. How can you have a night and day without the earth? The day depends upon the rotation of the earth. Without the earth created, how can you have a night and day? Point number four. Genesis chapter number 1, verse 9 to 13 says, earth was created on third day. Genesis chapter 1, verse 14 to 19 says, the sun and the moon was created on the fourth day. Today, science tells us that earth is part of the parent body, the sun. It cannot come into existence before the sun. It's unscientific. Point number five. The Bible says in Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 11 to 13, the vegetation, the herbs, the shrubs, the trees, they were created on the third day. And the sun, Genesis chapter number 1, verse 14 to 19, was created on the fourth day. How can the vegetation come into existence without sunlight? And how can they survive without sunlight? Point number six, that the Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, verse number 16, that God created two lights. The greater light, the sun, to rule the day, and the lesser light, the moon, to rule the night. The actual translation, if you go to the Hebrew text, it is lamps. Lamps, having light of its own. And that you'll come to know better if you read both the verses, Genesis chapter 1, verse 16 as well as 17. Verse number 17 says, and Almighty God placed them in the firmament to give light to the earth. To give light to the earth, indicating that sun and the moon has its own light, which is in contradiction with established scientific knowledge that we have. There are certain people who try and reconciliate and say that the 6 days mentioned in the Bible, it actually refers to epochs like the Quran, long period, not 624 days. It's illogical. You read the Bible, evening, morning, it clearly states 24 hours, it indicates. But even if I use a concordist approach, no problem. I agree with your illogical argument. Yet, they will only be able to solve the first scientific error of 6 days creation, and second, that first day light and third day earth. The remaining four, yet they cannot solve. Some further say that if it's a 24 period, why can't the vegetables survive for 124 day without sunlight? I say, fine. If you say that, the vegetables were created before the sun and can survive for 124 days, I have got no objection. But you can't say the days mentioned are 24 hours as well as epochs. You can't have the cake and eat it both. If you say it is long period, you solve point number one and three. The remaining four are yet there. If you say the days are 24 days, you solve only point number five. The remaining five are yet there. It becomes unscientific. I leave it to Dr. William Campbell whether he wants to say it is long period and say that there are only four scientific errors, or say it is a 24 days and say there are only five scientific errors in the creation of the universe. Regarding the concept of Earth, there are various scientists who have described how will the world end. Hypothesis. Some may be right, some may be wrong. But either the world will perish or the world will live forever. Both cannot take place simultaneously. It's unscientific. But this is exactly what the Bible says. It's mentioned in the Bible, in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 1, verse number 10 and 11, and in the book of Psalms, chapter number 102, verse number 25 and 26, that Almighty God created the heavens and the earth, and they will perish. Exactly opposite is mentioned in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter number 1, verse number 4, and the book of Psalms, chapter number 78, verse number 69, that the earth will abide forever. I leave it to Dr. William Campbell to choose which of the two verses are unscientific, the first pair or the second pair. One has to be unscientific. Both cannot take place. The world cannot abide forever as well as perish. It's unscientific. Regarding the heavens, the Bible says in Job chapter 26 verse 11 that the pillars of the heaven will tremble. Quran says in Surah Luqman chapter 31 verse number 10 that the heavens are without any pillars. Don't you see it? Don't you see the heavens are without any pillars? Bible says heaven has got pillars. Not only do the heavens have got pillars, Bible says in the first book of Samuel, chapter number 2, verse number 8, as well as the book of Job, chapter number 9, verse number 6, and the book of Psalms, chapter number 75, verse number 3, that even the earth have got pillars. In the field of diet and nutrition, let's analyze what does the Bible say. The Bible says in the book of Genesis, chapter number 1, verse number 29, that God has given you all the herbs bearing seeds, the trees bearing fruits, those that bear seed, as meat for you. New International Version says, the seed bearing plant and the trees bearing fruits, bearing seeds, are food for you, all of them. Today, even a layman knows that there are several poisonous plants like wild berries, strychnine, datura, plants containing alkaloid, oleander, buckeye pod, that which if you ingest, if you eat, there are high possibilities you may die. How come the creator of the universe and human beings doesn't know that if you have these plants, you will die? I hope Dr. William Campbell doesn't give this vegetarian diet to his patients. The Bible has a scientific test how to identify a true believer. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 16, verse number 17 and 18. It says that there will be signs for true believers, and amongst the signs, in my name, they shall cast out devils. They shall speak foreign tongues, new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink deadly poison, they shall not be harmed. And when they place their hand over the sick, they shall be cured. This is a scientific test. In scientific terminology, it's known as the confirmatory test for a true Christian believer. In the past 10 years of my life, I have personally interacted with thousands of Christians, including missionary. I have not come across a single Christian who has passed this confirmatory test of the Bible. I have not come across a single Christian who took poison. I have not come across any who took poison and who has not died. And in scientific terminology, this is also called as a falsification test. That means if a false person tries and does this test, takes poison, he will die. And a false person will not dare attempt this test. If you are not a true Christian believer, You will not dare attempt this test. Because if you try and attempt the falsification test, you will fail. So a person who is not a true Christian believer will never attempt this test. I have read the book, the Quran, the Bible in the light of history and science, written by Dr. William Campbell. And I assume that he is a true Christian believer. And at least I would like him to confirm to me about the falsification test. Please be rest assured. I will not ask Dr. William Campbell to have deadly poison because I don't want to jeopardize the debate. What I'll do, I will only ask him to speak in foreign tongues, in new languages. And as many of you may be aware, that India is a land which has more than 1,000 languages and dialects. Only thing I request him is to say these three words, 100 rupees, in the 17 official languages. There are only 17 official languages in India. And to make it easier for Dr. William Campbell, I've got a 100 rupee note. And this has all the 17 languages mentioned here. Besides English and Hindi, I will help him. I'll give him a beginning. 100 rupiah in Hindi. The remaining 15 languages are here. I'll request him to read. I know the test says they will speak foreign languages on their own without the help of reading. But I want to make the test easier. I want to see someone passing the test. I have not seen anyone. So if he can't say it on his own or from his memory, at least read it. I don't mind. I will accept it. And I request the chairperson to give it to Dr. William Campbell. He has his rebuttal. 15 languages, 100 rupiah, three words only. What does the Bible say regarding hydrology? Bible says in Genesis, chapter number 9, verse number 13 to 17, that after God, at the time of Noah, submerged the world by flood, and after the flood subsided, he said, I put up a rainbow in the sky as a promise to the humankind never to submerge the world again by water. To the unscientific person, it may be quite good. Oh, rainbow is a sign of Almighty God, never to submerge the world by flood again. But today we know very well that rainbow is due to the refraction of sunlight with rain or mist. Surely there may have been thousands of rainbows before the time of Noah, peace be upon him. To say it was not there before Noah's time, we have to assume that the law of refraction did not exist, which is unscientific. In the field of medicine, the Bible says in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 14, verse number 49 to 53, it gives a novel way for disinfecting a house from plague of leprosy. Disinfecting a house from plague of leprosy. It says that take two birds, kill one bird, take wood, scarlet, hyssop, and the other living bird, dip it in water, and under running water, later on, sprinkle the house seven times with it. Sprinkle the house with blood to disinfect against plague of leprosy? We know blood is a good media of germ, bacteria, as well as toxin. I hope Dr. William Campbell doesn't use this method of disinfecting the OT, the operation theater. It's mentioned in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 12, verse number 1 to 5. And we know medically that after a mother gives birth to a child, the postpartum period, it is unhygienic. To say it's unclean religiously, I've got no objection. But Leviticus, chapter number 12, verse number 1 to 5 says that after a woman gives birth to a male child, she will be unclean for 7 days. And the period of uncleanliness will continue for 33 days more. If she gives birth to a female child, she'll be unclean for 2 weeks. And the period of uncleanliness will continue for 66 days. In short, if a woman gives birth to a male child, a son, she is unclean for 40 days. If she gives birth to a female child, a daughter, she's unclean for 80 days. I would like Dr. William Campbell to explain to me scientifically, how come a woman remain unclean for double the period if she gives birth to a female child as compared to a male child? The Bible also has a very good test for adultery. How to come to know a woman has committed adultery? In Book of Numbers, chapter number 5, verse number 11 to 31. I'll just say in brief. It says that the priest should take holy water in a vessel, take dust from the floor and put it into the vessel. And that's the bitter water. And after cursing it, give it to the woman. And if the woman has committed adultery, after she drinks it, the curse will enter her body, the stomach will swell, the thigh will rot, and she shall be cursed by the people. If the woman has not committed adultery, she will remain clean and she will bear the seed. A novel method of identifying whether a woman has committed adultery or not. You know, today in the world, there are thousands of cases pending in different parts of the world, in different courts of law, only on the assumption that someone has alleged that the woman has committed adultery. I had read in the newspapers, and I came to know from the media, that the president of this great country, Mr. Bill Clinton, he was involved in a sex scandal about 2 years back. I wonder that why didn't the American court use this bitter water test for adultery? He would have gone scot-free immediately. Why didn't the Christian missionaries of this great country, especially those who are in the medical field, like my respected Dr. William Campbell, use this bitter water test to bail out their president immediately? Mathematics is a branch which is closely associated with science, with which you can solve problems, etc. There are thousands of contradictions in the Bible. Hundreds deal with mathematics. I'll just touch on few of them. It's mentioned in Ezra chapter number 2, verse number 1, and Nehemiah chapter number 7, verse number 6, the context, that when the people returned from exile from Babylon, when King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, when he released the men from Israel, they came back from captivity, and the list of the people are given. The list is given in Ezra chapter number 2, verse number 2 to 63, and Nehemiah chapter number 7, verse number 7 up to 65. The list is given with the names as well as number of people released. In these 60 verses, there are no less than 18 times the name is exactly the same, but the number is different. There are no less than 18 contradictions in less than 60 verses of these two chapters. This is the list. I don't have time to run through the list. There are no less than 18 different contradictions in less than 60 verses. Further, it's mentioned in Ezra, chapter number 2, verse number 64, that the total congregation, if you add up, it comes to 42,360. And if you read in Nehemiah, chapter number 7, verse number 66, they're also totally the same, 42,360. But if you add up all these verses, which I had to do my homework, this is a list. This is a list of Ezra. This is a list of Nehemiah. Ezra chapter number 2, Nehemiah chapter number 7. If you add up in Ezra chapter number 2, it doesn't come to 42,360, it comes to 29,818. And if you add up Nehemiah chapter number 7, even there it doesn't come to 42,360, it comes to 31,089. The author of the Bible, presumed to be Almighty God, does not know simple addition. If you give this problem even to a person who passed elementary school, he'll be able to get the right answer. If you add up all the 60 verses, it's so easy, Almighty God. Didn't know adding knows billah, if we presume that this is the word of God. Further, if we read in Ezra chapter number 2, verse number 65, it says there were 200 singing men and women. Nehemiah chapter number 7, verse 67, there were 245 singing men and women. Were they 200 or were they 245 singing men and women? Context is the same, a mathematical contradiction. It's mentioned in the 2 Kings, chapter number 24, verse number 8, that Joachim was 18 years old when he began to reign Jerusalem. And he reigned for 3 months and 10 days. 2 Chronicles, chapter number 36, verse number 9 says that Joachim was 8 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned for 3 months, 10 days. Was Joachim 18 years when he began to reign, or was he 8 years old? Did he reign for 3 months, or did he reign for 3 months, 10 days? Further, it's mentioned in the 1 Kings, chapter number 7, verse number 26, that in Solomon's temple, in his molten sea, he had 2,000 baths. In 2 Chronicles, chapter number 4, verse number 5, he had 3,000 baths. Did he have 2,000 baths, or did he have 3,000 baths? That I leave it upon Dr. William Campbell to decide which is correct. There is a clear-cut mathematical contradiction. Furthermore, it's mentioned in the 1 Kings, chapter number 15, verse number 33, that Baasha, he died in the 26th year of reign of Asa. And 2 Chronicles, chapter number 16, verse number 1 says that Baasha invaded Judah in the 36th year of the reign of Asa. How can Baasha invade 10 years after his death? It's unscientific. To make it easier for Dr. William Campbell to answer to the points I have raised, I'll just mention it in brief, the points that I mentioned. The first point was that the creation of the earth and the heaven, the universe, was in 624 days. Light was there before the source of light, point number 2. 3, day came into existence before creation of earth, point number 4. Earth came into existence before sun, point number 5. Vegetation came into existence before sunlight, point number 6. Light of the moon is its own light, point number 7. The earth, will it perish or will it abide forever? Point number 8, the earth has got pillars. Point number 9, the heavens have got pillars. Point number 10, God said you can have all plants and all vegetation, including the poisonous plants. Point number 11, the scientific test, the falsification test of Mark chapter number 16, verse number 17 and 18. Point number 12, a woman remains unclean for double the period if she gives birth to a daughter as compared to a son. Point number 13, using blood to disinfect the house against plague of leprosy. Point number 14, how do you find out the bitter water test for adultery? Point number 15, 18 different contradictions in less than 60 verses of Ezra chapter 2 and Nehemiah chapter number 7. I didn't count them as 18 different, I've counted them only as one. Point number 16, the total is different in both the chapters. Point number 17, are there 200 singing men and women, or are there 245 singing men and women? Point number 18, was Joachim 18 years old, or was he 8 years old when he began to reign? Point number 19, did he reign for 3 months or 3 months, 10 days? Point number 20, did Solomon had 3,000 baths or 2,000 baths? Point number 21 is that Baasha, how could he invade Judah 10 years after his death? Point number 22 is Almighty God. He said, I put up a rainbow in the sky as a promise to the humankind never to submerge the world again by water. I have listed only 22 out of the hundreds available unscientific points in the Bible, scientific errors, and I request Dr. William Campbell to answer them, and irrespective whether he uses the concordance approach or the conflict approach, as long as he's logical, he will never be able to prove scientifically all these 22 aspects I've told him. We agree in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, to him was revealed the Injil. This is not the Injil. It may contain part of God, but the other unscientific portion is not the word of God. I would like to end my talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 17, which says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَّهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَّهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say this is from Allah, to traffic with it for a miserable price. Woe to those for what they write, woe to those for what they earn. واخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.
I would request our audience to bear with us and maintain a due decorum.